Hello, everyone, and greetings from Washington State University. I am delighted to extend a warm welcome to you all for our Global Vision keynote presentation today, to be delivered by Dr. Sven-Erik Jacobsen. So many of you may know Sven-Erik through his extensive and highly collaborative quinoa research in many different countries around the world. Some of you may also know Sven-Erik because you've grown a few of his excellent quinoa varieties, such as Titicaca, Puno, Vikinga. I first had the pleasure of meeting Sven-Erik when he came to Washington State University in 2013 for the first International Quinoa Research Symposium. And there he delivered a really deeply thoughtful and insightful presentation based on his hard-earned and decades-long experience working with quinoa. Sven-Erik Jacobsen is the managing director and founder of the company Quinoa Quality APS that works for the promotion of quinoa and other high-value alternative crops to enhance biodiversity, soil fertility, and food security in developing countries, as well as Europe and throughout the rest of the world. Sven-Erik holds a PhD in crop science from the University of Copenhagen, and he's worked with other minor high-quality crops, many in the legume family, although his focus throughout his career has largely been on the Andean grain crop quinoa. He's initiated a quinoa breeding program many years ago, which has resulted in these quinoa cultivars I mentioned, and they have been able to yield well and mature under these temperate conditions, which has really revolutionized quinoa growing throughout much of the world. So today, Sven-Erik continues to look into the future, developing new quinoa cultivars and new crops, which may contribute to the mitigation of climate change, secure high-quality food, help the development of plant-based food, and increase our agro-biodiversity and food diversity. So please join me in giving Sven-Erik a warm welcome. And Sven, we look forward to your presentation today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for being invited to be here. And I'm happy to be here, even if it's in a digital way and not the personal one, but I appreciate the initiative you have taken here from Washington State University and the whole team. Thanks a lot for that. What I'm going to talk about today is a presentation of myself. It has already been done. The global vision, potential solutions to our problems, the research gaps with respect to quinoa, breeding efforts, market opportunities, target consumers, product development and economy, and finally some of the activities in my enterprise. So this is the presentation of myself, and you can have a look at that yourself if you're more interested. I think we should go to the global vision and the main challenges we are facing. We are facing a population growth in globally, and we will reach around 9 billion people in a few decades. We are facing climate changes all over the world in different ways, and we are seeing increasing meat consumption. And this increasing meat consumption is actually very serious for us and for affecting the climate in a negative way. Here we see the increase in consumption of meat during the last 60 years. In the bottom you see beef, in the middle you see pigs, and on the top you see the chicken, and they are all increasing. So what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to decrease the consumption of meat and replace it by plant-based food. And the way to do that is to look for relevant crops to expand our agrobiodiversity and produce a much larger range of crops for our food. And in that way, to improve our food security and our health by processing and developing new products based on these plant-based foods. And in the end, to boost the bioeconomy in working in collaboration with farmers, with the private and governmental programs and companies, and focusing on the market. What we see here is the picture of the agro biodiversity, or you can see it's the opposite, because we see that again during the last 60 years we have seen a constant increase in the cultivation of the major crops in the world. And now the three major crops, which is all cereals, rice, maize and wheat, actually are covering 60% of the global food calories in the world. We can also see it in another way. If you take some of the new crops, not new, but the crops that that we believe will should have an increasing importance in the future, which are the legumes, which can provide protein for our food. We see that in Europe, 60 years ago, we had 4% of the European area was covered by legumes, and now today it's only 1.5%. This curve should have been the opposite, but this is not the case, as you see, of course, but we have to change it and get on the right track. So what are the potential solutions for mitigate some of these problems and actually go into to these problems and find ways to secure a sustainable agriculture and food production in the future? We should improve our crop rotations with much more crops, much larger range of diversity. We should look at new technologies, and they can sometimes be based on ancient or traditional technologies, but modernized in a way so they fit, you can say, modern agriculture. And finally, we should look at new genetic material. This is what I will go into in more details. But if we are focusing on all these three aspects here, we are going to improve the food safety of the world, and we will improve the environmental and economical sustainability. Focusing on the new genetic material, what should we look into? We can look into new varieties of already grown crops, or you can say the major or the traditional crops, and look for stress tolerance among these crops in gene banks in different varieties, make screenings, and we can also look into the protein level and other aspects. But we could also, instead of that, or we could do both, of course, or we should do both, also look into new crops, who already has some of these characteristics with respect to stress tolerance, with respect to nutritional quality and other properties which we are looking for. So an example of these crops which could be interesting is a range of the ending crops I have collected here. We see on the big picture, we see the quinoa in the southern part of Bolivia. We see amaranth, we see the Andean lupin or tarabi, and we see the caniva, all extremely valuable crops which should be grown much more than they are, and we should be consumed much more than they are at the moment. And here is a study of the adaptation of some of these crops, including the legumes and the quinoa. And we have seen, it is based on a prediction of the climate in 2050. And the red color tells us that that the crop is not adapted at all, and the blue color says that it's well adapted. So what you see on this picture is that especially the soybean will get into huge problems. It will be very little and adapted to the predicted climate we will see, with more drought, more extreme weather, and higher temperatures. The other legumes that we have included here are better adapted to, but mostly to specific areas of Europe. But if you look at the quinoa, it's much bluer and greener in color. So it's definitely the crop with most adaptability to production in Europe, based on the predicted climate changes that we will see. So, what is the benefits of quinoa? We all know that. I suppose it's protein content, but mainly the protein quality and the high content of vitamins and minerals. It's tolerant to several abiotic stress factors, drought, frost, and salinity. And also, we have an increasing market and a huge year market for quinoa and quinoa-related products. So, a part of the two main countries where we grow quinoa, which is Peru and Bolivia, there are trials and commercial production in many other countries of the world. And I will just give some few examples here. This is from Argentina, where they are looking into production of quinoa on the Pampa, in the lowlands. This is from Ecuador, where they for a long time have had a commercial production of the crop. This is from Washington State. This is actually where we were supposed to be, but unfortunately we are at home by our computers. And we have here from the Middle East, in Iran. We have from Egypt, where the quinoa is irrigated by rather saline water from the Nile. We have quinoa in Morocco, the harvest of quinoa. This is from Denmark, Germany, Norway, in northern Europe, you can and this is from Australia, nice. This is from France, and this is from Spain. But those are only examples. Actually, more or less all over the world, there are trials and efforts with quinoa. So, what are the research gaps that we are experiencing in quinoa? First of all, adaptation to new environments, where we should focus on the abiotic stresses, which I've already mentioned, mainly the drought and heat, but also excessive rains could be mentioned here, and combinations of the different stresses. But also the biotic stresses, which I've mentioned here first, are very, very important, and we see increasing problems in new environments with the diseases and the pests. Also, the yield stability is we should work on, so we don't get these fluctuations in yield from year to year, that we get more stable. The quality issues, we have high protein quality, but we could look at the protein level and still maintaining the protein quality. We could look into the dietary fibers, also seed size, color, and transfer of diseases on the seed are important gaps in the research, and then we should look into the breeding technologies. The main disease we know in quinoa is the Peronospora. Downy mildew, which we see to the left, what we have found out in studies here in Denmark, that there are actually several other diseases affecting the guinea worm, PhD student Carla is working on it right now, and it's quite interesting. And it will, and for instance, this scenario which you see in the bottom of the to the right this year in Northern Europe than we've seen before. We have several pests affecting the quinoa. We have this similar to the main pest in South America. We also have that type of Lepidoptera in Europe. We have the black aphids and the green aphids. Mainly the black aphid is a big problem. We have these minor mining insects and the alteca, which can attack in the very early stages of the crop, and another weevil here, and another bug also, and this here. So and they have all been described more or less in the literature, and some of them are from personal experience. But we see that when we grow quinoa in under new environments, we will have new pests coming in, which we have to take into consideration. So, what are the breeding, or how should we conduct the breeding for improving quinoa in the future? As you see here, we should aim for the next green revolution, which should be a sustainable one, which should focus on a wider diversity of crops. So, and this can be done by classical breeding, but we may also look into new technologies, molecular technologies, and use them in a wise way. The GMOs have not entered into quinoa yet, and it's a question if it's the way to go, because of you can say consumer resistance, but in EU it's very difficult to be able to grow crops on a commercial scale which are GMOs. So there seems to be very little future at the moment for GMOs in Europe, but the case is different in the United States. The same with the CRISPR technology, which is also a GMO, defined as a GMO here in Europe, and it will also face problems. So therefore you should go to other techniques like the tilling technique, targeting induced local lesions in genomes, where you have different ways, different types, where you can use these local lesions on which specific mutations in the gene, and then you can look for mutations in genes you're interested in, and then the challenge is to find the mutations afterwards, and there are works in that, and it seems to be very interesting. And maybe I think we should try to combine the molecular and genetic techniques with traditional breeding for having the best results in the future. So what are the opportunities for on the market? Well, the way that we have been working on the market is to promote it together with the chefs, and we did that in South America, in Peru, actually, where we collaborated with Academy of Gastronomy and made courses for chefs and cooks. And after that, we arranged festivals where the participants could present their products. And this was a great success, and we did that in three different places in Peru, and it was, as I said, it was a success. So it was such a success that we also did it when I returned to Denmark many years later, here with Danish chefs and a complete buffet of quinoa and a lot of journalists and press was present, and it entered into magazines and newspapers, and it has stayed there since then. So quinoa is very well known in Denmark and in also other places in Europe. Very nice to work with the amaranth. Here you see what we call the quinoa dish, and a tray of quinoa. It's a picture from my own kitchen for the delicious meals. In Washington, we saw that quinoa can be used for vodka, so that's the interest there. Very nice also, and here we have some meat boxes where quinoa is also entered. Other products you see here, you see the simple products to the left, which is whole grain, the flour and the flakes, which you can use for the porridge, which is normally with oats, and you can combine oat and what we call spreads and ice cream, which is a more processed way of using. Actually, it's not from this, not quinoa, it's lupin and all that, but still some of these new products that we should look into. A quinoa burger, and here what you can call artificial meat. It looks exactly like minced meat, but it's made from plants, not from quinoa in as a start, but it shows the way to go in the future. So who are the target consumers? You can say that we made a study in a previous project and saw that there was 5% which were completely avoiders, so you can say vegans. 65% they wanted to or they tried to reduce meat, and 30% were completely lost because they loved the quinoa. And we saw that the most interested group was the young people, especially the female of the millennium and previous generations, and the urban, and what they did was that they wanted to change more than anyone else, and mainly it was from environmental concerns. And they replaced the meat by different products, but some of them was the pulses and the nuts and quinoa. And we also tested the different plant-based products, and we can see that there were different products like was the most appreciated, like quinoa burgers, some sato and vegetarian chicken. So we should focus on product development and the economy to reach the consumer in the future, and we use our raw products to put through some either yes, what I would say is that we can either use them directly, or we can process them and get ingredients. And we can also look into groups of products and in an upstream production, where we look into the use of water, the effect on climate change, soil fertility, and so on. Present some models in processing and the downstream functionalities in the end be able to produce healthy and tasty food, which has been organic or non-organic, GMO, local, or fair trade, on rainforest. All these characteristics which can be taken positive or negative, but we should be on this. We should decide in which way we want to go and which way we will be. The economy of the keynote we see here with different yield levels and different prices, and compared to fava bean, barley, and sugar beet, and we see that the profit for the farmer in Europe is actually good, even with the lowest price and the lowest yield we put here, and it is very soon better profit from kino than from barley.
So, how much kino has actually grown in the world? Yes, I said from the beginning that two main countries are Peru and Bolivia, and then we have some production in Europe, and my estimation is that there are around 8,000 hectares in Asia, and that's mainly in China. We have around 13,000 hectares in Africa, around 1,000, and in other countries like Australia. And so in total, there is about 200,000 hectares of quinoa, and the price for the farmer seems to be around 2 euro per kilo, and compared with the cereals, which are much lower, and but with the yields, it's the opposite, that the yields of cereals are higher than quinoa, but in the end, we saw that there could be an economy in it. Then just very, very briefly, the activities of quinoa quality is to promote conservation and market of quinoa and other high quality crops, to participate in breeding programs with Bolivia, with Argentina, with European countries, participate in research and development projects, create a product catalog with the crops, participate in publications, create a quinoa university on our webpage, which is under creation, and collaborate with all people who are lovers and believe in quinoa and other crops. So here are the crops we are working with here at the moment in Europe and outside also. Quinoa, amaranth, camelina is a promising crop, and many other crops, so which you can see here. So conclusion is, what did we actually talk about? We talked about the global vision, where we have to face the climate changes, where we have to find ways to replace meat by plant-based food, and we have to increase our biodiversity. All this, we have quinoa as one of the tools to come in. We have a range of research gaps where we have to work hard in the future. All the scientists who are interested, all the universities, but also together with private companies and others. And we have many market opportunities, but actually I see the market as one of the major bottlenecks for the development of the quinoa and increasing the production. And we have some target consumers, and we have some important product developments of quinoa, which can make quinoa successful not only now, but also in the future. So thank you very much. I think I try to do it within the time limits. So I hope I manage. Thank you very much.